Okay, so how did everything get started? Really, technology isn't my forte. But on the other hand, accessibility is. I have one man by the name of Matt Wind. He's a technology specialist at Towson University. We started talking one day, and he asked me, he said, "What does accessibility for deaf people look like?" He stated that he was familiar with internet accessibility for blind users, such as audio text to voice, screen magnifiers, braille lettering. What about deaf users? And I said, "Wow, that's a good point. Sure, there's English written text, but is that really enough? Not really. Us deaf people prefer the use of sign language. If written English text interpreted in ASL were present on the internet, what would that be like for deaf people?" And that's how this project was created. So I'm going to go ahead and elaborate on these 4 points. The first, accessibility and technology. What does that look like in the current world of the internet? Second, concerns related to internet accessibility. Are deaf people able to access the internet fully? Third, the creation of a pilot study with deaf participants from the local community. We gathered their feedback on accessibility related to website design and internet use. Lastly, suggestions on new ideas to consider in the future. There's a new trend in a term called universal usability. And what that means is there are considerations in the design technology process for accessibility purposes of users with a variety of needs. For example, someone who has an arm amputated, or someone who is paralyzed from the waist down and is only able to move his or her head. Technological design accommodations have been created to act as the mouse on a computer. Audio input for blind users, accessibility provided by wheelchair ramps. So, what does that mean for the deaf community? What does that look like? Also, the concept of universal usability emphasizes the creation of all accommodations be a part of the initial design process, as opposed to being added later as an afterthought, including the creation of website design. Internet accessibility for deaf people has never really been discussed before until now. U.S. federal guidelines state that captions or some form of written text must be implemented to facilitate visual comprehension and accessibility in the form of reading for deaf individuals. But the reality is, written text in English are not enough to create access for the deaf community. There are several reasons for this claim, and the main one is that, for deaf individuals, ASL is most likely their native language and primary use of communication, while English tends to be their second language. The process of learning how to read typically deals with audio input and making the connection between the sounds of spoken words and what is seen in written text. So for deaf people, where is the access to the fundamental process of learning how to read? There definitely are some deaf individuals who are extremely comfortable with reading English, and these individuals typically have a college education. As far as the rest of the population, that doesn't ring true. So far, there have been two different policy guidelines created by computer specialists in the field. One of the two guidelines state that there should be some form of interpretation in sign language as a part of the web design layout. And the other one states that the written text should be included in conjunction with the sign language interpretation. It's very impressive that these guidelines have been written and put in place, but it falls short in the actual implementation of the website design process. And that's really concerning. Technology has such a tremendous amount of benefits. How does that apply to the deaf community? For deaf people, signing is so important and having visual access to that. Modern technology has given deaf people the access to video recording and has become so crucial in the sending and receiving of information easily and effortlessly. This ability to exchange information back and forth is just so important. In recent studies, researchers have found that in younger deaf generations, most prefer receiving information through a combination of sign language translation along with captioning. Deeper analysis of this has found that the combination method of signed translation and captioned transliteration does not cause cognitive load and overstimulation in the user. It turns out it's actually a very effective way of receiving information from the internet. So how do we determine what is the best way to provide internet access to the deaf community? Well, we put together a team of us and started brainstorming ideas. We came up with the creation of a pilot study using four different sample website designs. And once they were created, I went on to the deaf community and recruited participants. Altogether, we recruited 21 individuals with a wide range of backgrounds. Participants varied in ages ranging from 20 years old to mid-70s. Educational backgrounds, those who had completed high school and had their diploma, to those having their master's degrees. Participants varying in age in which they learned sign, for some of them being exposed to sign language since birth and signing at a very young age. And for others, sign language was not available to them until after high school. Of those 21 people, there was a good balance between male and female participants. So I met with each participant individually and had him or her view all four samples. Afterwards, I asked them questions about each sample. For example, what did you like or dislike about each design? What they thought was clear or perhaps unclear about the layout of each sample. And I would ask them to summarize the content of the page. Their responses were videotaped and later recorded. Now for the web design aspect and a little bit about what each sample looks like. So sample A, we used Towson University's original webpage titled Emergency Preparedness. The format of this page is designed with written English text information at the top of the page and the video directly below it. The video is about 8 minutes long and we were able to cut it into four short clips. The first clip in sample A is an auditory video with captions embedded below, which can be turned on and off. And sample B, it has the same web page layout, but there is a thumbnail video interpretation located to the left of the written text. When the thumbnail is clicked, it expands to fit the screen, overlapping the original web page. The video gives the signed version of the text located behind it. When the user is done with the interpretation video, they can click off the screen and the window goes back to its original format. Now below there's the video clip with an embedded signed interpretation to the right of the live screen. As the clip plays, the interpretation goes along with it. And there's captioning at the very bottom, which can be turned on and off. Sample C. The webpage format is the same, but the layout is a bit different. The thumbnail interpretation is located to the left of the English text, and when clicked, it does not expand. The thumbnail interpretation interprets the English text and then goes on to interpret the video clip at the bottom directly afterwards. Captions are also included and can be turned on and off. And lastly, sample D. So to the left of the English text is a small thumbnail video that interprets what's written. And then below that, the video clip has its own embedded interpretation as well. And then the captions, which can be turned on and off. So what's different about sample B and sample D is that the video for the text doesn't enlarge to fit the screen in sample D like it does in sample B. And they both have the same format for the video clip interpretation. The first set of results is measured on a scale of 1 to 5, 1 being lousy and 5 being excellent based on the overall design structure and layout of the website. When the participants were done viewing all of these samples, I asked them to rate each sample that they just viewed. The results concluded with a majority of the participants rating a 5 for both samples B and D. Next, I asked the participants which sample they felt was most welcoming. Participants chose sample B, with sample D coming in close second. Then I asked the participants which sample they felt was the most clear and easy to understand. Participants preferred sample D, with sample B coming in close second. What sets sample B and D apart from sample A and C is that the layout of sample B and sample D both have a separate interpretation for not only the written text, but also an interpretation for the video clip down below. This is the part of the survey where I asked the participants to tell me how they felt about each sample, and then asked them to summarize the content of information. So the first question I asked was, which sample did you like, and which did you not like? For this question, participants were able to pick more than one as their preferred option, and still most picked B and D, with A being the least preferred option. Then I went on to ask comprehensive questions. The first question was related to the information in the written English text. So first I asked the participants to summarize the content without having the signed option. Then I asked them to summarize the written content after viewing the signed interpretation. The results found that after participants saw the interpreted version, they were able to better comprehend and summarize the content of written information on the page. Without the signed interpretation, participants had a hard time summarizing back to me the content on the page. As for the video, the results were similar. Comprehension was present when the signed interpretation was embedded into the video clip, along with the option for captioning at the bottom. When there was no signed interpretation for the video clip and only captions were provided, participants had a difficult time recreating the content of the video. Now, imagine what can be created from this initial pilot study. Starting from just 21 people and expanding that number to thousands of individuals in the deaf community all over the United States. In a study conducted on a grand scale, I'm very curious what we could find. So, now you've seen the results. They're definitely exciting, and this is also a good start. So now it opens up the possibility to consider what it might actually look like to have signed ASL interpretation implemented on the web as part of the design process. This method could create full accessibility for the deaf population in obtaining information on the internet. I think this study makes it very clear that with written text, there is not enough access to information for those who are deaf. A proposal for the future would be to consider including those who are deaf to be a part of the design process when creating future web pages. And if you are ever feeling unsure, ask a deaf person for advice. I think that's very important and maybe something to consider when working with deaf people in the future.